As the U-2 high-altitude reconnaissance aircraft flew over the skies in the late 1950s, American and Taiwanese pilots tried to get a closer look at the desert area in the northern Xinjiang province. Rampant speculation about the possibility of a Chinese nuclear program had been brewing for years, and skepticism increased when the Soviets withdrew their monetary and technical support. However, upon closer inspection, the Allied pilots were stunned to find a completed atomic reactor in the Lop Nur testing site. The men photographed the device on the spot and immediately showed it to top-ranking intelligence officials, as it seemed finished and capable of producing destructive nuclear power. It seemed like the suspicions were finally confirmed, and there was nothing the United States could do about it. Get with the times. Prompted by continuous confrontations with the United States throughout the 1950s, Mao Zedong, the ruler of the People's Republic of China, expressed his intention of developing atomic weapons in front of the Secretariat of the Communist Party of China. Among the contributing factors were the Korean War, the Taiwan Strait Crisis, nuclear blackmail, and later on the Vietnam War, in which the up-and-coming communist nation butted heads with the US. Chairman Mao was confident that nuclear weapon capabilities would allow the Republic of China to assert its national will and interests towards global policy goals and deter threats to their national security. Justifying his decision in a gathering of the Politburo of the Chinese Communist Party in 1956, Chairman Mao confidently explained, quote, "Now we're already stronger than we were in the past, and in the future we'll be even stronger than now. Not only are we going to have more airplanes and artillery, but also the atomic bomb. In today's world, if we don't want to be bullied, we have to have this thing." The initial meeting set off the preparations for the Chinese nuclear weapons program that same year, and hundreds of top-rated scientists were called to create a development outline. Nuclear research at the Institute of Physics and Atomic Energy in Beijing had finally begun. Two bombs, one satellite. In 1957, China and its ally, the Soviet Union, signed an agreement to share defense technology. The contract involved an atomic bomb prototype supplied by Moscow, as well as technical data and the exchange of hundreds of each nation's scientists. After a thorough search operation for viable uranium performed by top Soviet geologists, the team finally found a location near Lake Lop Nur in the northern side of Xinjiang province. The place was then selected to become the program's official test site, with the headquarters established at the Milan Air Base. Not even 3 years after the idea's initial conception, Chairman Mao officially announced the development of their own nuclear power program, called Two Bombs, One Satellite. The program was named after the atomic bomb and the Intercontinental Ballistic Missile, or ICBM, while One Satellite referred to an artificial satellite. Construction of the site began in April of 1960 and involved thousands of laborers working in inhumane conditions for 4 years. Being the only site for nuclear testing in China, the Lop Nur testing site has undergone extensive expansion and repairs throughout the decades, and to this day, it is the world's largest test site, covering no less than 38,610 square miles. American reaction. The United States intelligence continually monitored Chinese developments, and American agents were well aware of the newest nuclear program and the Soviets' involvement in it. Hampered by the lack of adequate or thorough sources, the mystery of the program was met with anxiety, and opinions within top officials of the U.S. government varied widely as to how to handle the matter. Thus began an internal debate within the United States over the significance and real-world implications of the Chinese nuclear capability. Analysts from the State Department's Bureau of Intelligence and Research and the RAND Corporation, a nonprofit global policy think tank funded by the government for research and examination of the U.S. armed forces, estimated that China would act cautiously and rationally while exploiting political opportunities that come with nuclear power. However, the Institute for Defense Analyses, a corporation that administers federally funded research to assist the government in addressing national security issues regarding science and technology, was confident that China would definitely show hostility to the point of active nuclear operations. After analyzing all opposing views, President John F. Kennedy proposed several preventative measures. However, many government officials believed that this would be perceived as provocative and even dangerous, as China's intention was probably to portray the United States as a source of tension and the main threat to peace against Asia. The New York Times reported that only a few months before his untimely passing, in September of 1963, President Kennedy met with General Chiang Ching-kuo, a politician of the Republic of China after it retreated to Taiwan, to discuss the program. Although the general affirmed that it would be a long time before the Chinese communists attained nuclear capability, he added that China would become a mighty threat to the entire world if and when they initiated it. Independent Program. Two bombs, one satellite hit a speed bump when the Sino-Soviet relationship cooled down due to the lack of Soviet assistance in stopping the Tibetan uprisings and the escape of the Dalai Lama to India. When the Sino-Indian War between China and India took place in the fall of 1962, while both nations disputed the Himalayan borders, Soviet Premier Nikita Khrushchev refused to support their ally, as the ruler was unnerved at Chairman Mao's relatively nonchalant view of nuclear warfare. According to the Russian politician, Mao once said, quote, "I'm not afraid of nuclear war. There are 2.7 billion people in the world. It doesn't matter if some are killed." In order to improve Soviet-American relationships, Russia began test-ban negotiations with the Americans in 1959, angering the Chinese. The disagreements continued to broaden as Soviet and Chinese communist ideologies escalated into mutual criticism. In response, the Soviets decided to withdraw the delivery of a prototype bomb in June of 1959 and sent 1,400 Russian advisors, engineers, and technicians involved in Chinese projects meant to foster cooperation between the two nations back to the homeland. This sudden rupture prompted China to continue their nuclear testing project on their own, renaming it Project 596 after the month and year in which the project became independent from Soviet funding. Chairman Mao's plan had now shifted to a policy of total self-reliance. By January of 1964, China had harvested enough fissionable uranium-235 from the Lanzhou plant, and as the preparations continued throughout the year, it became closer and closer to becoming the fifth nation in the world to have its own nuclear weapons, behind the United States, the Soviet Union, the United Kingdom, and France. Project 596. When the Russians withdrew the support from the Chinese nuclear program in 1959, United States officials continued to underestimate the nation's ability to develop an actual nuclear weapon without aid from the Soviets. However, China proved them wrong. In a daily meeting between Secretary of State Dean Rusk and the Bureau of Intelligence and Research, official George Denny reported that U-2 reconnaissance aircraft flown by American and Taiwanese pilots launched from Indian airbases had taken photographs that confirmed the existence of a completed atomic reactor in northern China. The device appeared capable of producing enough radioactive material for a few nuclear weapons. According to official Denny, the photographs were proof that the Chinese would be ready to detonate a small nuclear explosion soon. With this discovery, Washington initially expected China to test a plutonium device, just like all the other nuclear powers in the world. However, further intelligence collected by the Air Force proved that highly enriched U-235 uranium fueled the device from a then-unknown source. According to a Bureau of Intelligence and Research report, American intelligence experts were shocked and perplexed about how Beijing had acquired the dangerous and powerful material. And although Washington knew about the diffusion plant in Lanzhou, the top officials did not believe that it had been in operation long enough to produce enough uranium. Still, according to satellite photographs around the Lop Nur testing site taken in early 1964, it was clear that a Chinese nuclear test was imminent. As the days went by, the Defense Department's Office of International Security Affairs issued an alarming estimate of the alleged upcoming event, projecting 100 million American casualties in the event of war with China in 1980. Sure enough, on October 16, 1964, a 3,400-pound uranium-235 fission implosion device was detonated on a 330-foot tower atop the Lop Nur test site. Outcome. Project 596 was only the first of 45 Chinese nuclear tests conducted at Lop Nur, 23 of them atmospheric and 22 underground, with yields ranging from 1 kiloton to 4 megatons. Then, on June 17, 1967, only 3 years after Project 596, China detonated its first hydrogen bomb. While China's nuclear arsenal was modest when compared to the US or the Soviet Union, the presence of a new atomic power raised the issue of uncontrolled proliferation once again. The appearance of a new nuclear power in Asia would then prompt the Soviet Union to sign the Nuclear Non-Proliferation Treaty of 1968 with the United States and China. Meanwhile, the effects of China's nuclear testing on the environment remain unknown. A study carried out by Japanese physicist Professor Jun Takada suggests that peak levels of radioactivity from China's tests exceeded the estimates of the 1986 Chernobyl reactor accident. Today, China is one of the top three atomic powers in the world, just behind the United States and Russia. Thank you for watching our Dark Docs video. Don't forget to give us a like and let us know your thoughts in the comment section below. And please subscribe to this and all the channels from our Dark Documentaries family. Stay tuned.